Hello and welcome back to the MLG Pro League Championship here in Columbus, Ohio. We're now joined by Yapsor from the team Balkan Bears Corleone. It's nice to have you here.
Thank you.
And we'll get some insight of that guy in just a few minutes. But before that, you can already see it. We have a little golden Doom Demi Hero here standing on our desk with the cask, of course. And you can win that. And all you have to do is tweet us a pic of you watching MLG.tv/joinDOTA using the hashtag MLG Demi Hero. And I think that's a pretty darn easy way of winning something like that.
Puckett's got some luck, man.
Puckett's got some luck.
He just reaches in, grabs a buck, and it's a golden Doom. If I'm gonna buy any of these, I'm gonna have Puckett pick out which one.
Because me and Toby already went crazy on that. I got a golden one.
I have a golden tiny.
I have a golden tiny.
That's probably one of the best ones.
My problem was though that I really wanted to have the tiny figurine, and I think the golden one doesn't look good at all. So I had to go and buy myself another one, hoping it's not gonna be a golden again.
Oh, what a first world problem! Oh, I'm just getting too many golds.
Horrible.
Wow.
Yeah. That's about that. So make sure to tweet at us using said hashtag, and you might have the little golden doomling with the cask coming your way. So good luck to every one of you. And of course, I'm looking forward to take a look at the pictures of how you are watching this lovely tournament. Mm-hmm. How would you be watching, Yapsor? If you were at home right now, what would that setup look like?
Just me and my PC, I guess.
Do you have any munchies that you pull out? Anything special when it comes down to game time?
That you're just like,
okay.
Just
okay. Oh, wow. So healthy. So healthy. You're in America. You got to munch down a little bit here.
Yeah. What is your setup then, Cap?
My setup is as much as sugary food as I can get my hands on.
Nice.
Yes. I get all amped up while I'm sitting there in a chair.
Yeah, are you one of those annoying people when I'm one of those annoying people.
Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of those, you know, like when you're in a Skype call and then you start like playing together or like even watching a game together
and then someone's just like munch, munch, munch,
and you're like, ugh. Yeah. Good to know. I'm never going to be in a call with you.
Very well.
Glad we sorted that out. Now, actually, let's talk a little bit about the game ahead of us. It's going to be MVP Phoenix going up against the Ninjas in pajamas. Maybe let's get some insight from you since you're sitting here next to us. What was your experience so far with those two teams?
Well, we played them yesterday, and NiP, you could say they're like very consistent as a team, very defensive. They like to go mid late game, and we kind of went crazy in the game. We kept trying to kill them, and we shouldn't have played their game. That's what they wanted. They wanted to play defensive, and we played aggressive, which wasn't really the way you should play against them. MVP, you don't really know how to approach that game because they're very random. Nobody really understands their drafts, to be honest. But what we saw yesterday, what they focused on was mid game dominance, you can say. Like we won all our lanes, but each one of them got like a core item and some levels on their heroes, and they just started 5-man taking our towers. So yeah.
How would you describe your own playstyle then? Because it felt like we kind of described it when it was MVP Phoenix versus you guys. It felt like it was the team fight specialists and MVP Phoenix were very mid-game dominant. To you guys who are a bit more, like we've been calling you very pickoff oriented, would you agree with that assessment of your play style, that it's more aggressive and more focused on getting like the two versus two or those, you know, maybe those three-man ganks onto somebody and not necessarily full-on team fight?
Well, in MVP, yeah, we tried to go for the pickoff potential that we had. But once they started getting our towers, we weren't always in position to get the trades when we wanted to. So we tried to fight them. Mm-hmm. But then a horrible fight went out top lane where we lost two heroes before we could even start the fight at all. So it just opened up all the space that they can get.
Right.
They got two pickoffs and they don't even have a pickoff potential heroes except the Beastmaster, of course. So it just opened up everything. They started getting the objectives that they wanted to, especially after that Trax pick, the Draw Ranger.
So if we look at this upcoming match, MVP against NiP, how do you think they have to play it out, each of those teams, to win?
I think if they just both of them play their own game, it's going to be like exactly what we're expecting, because NiP are really defensive. They like to go mid late. And as we played MVP yesterday, they also like to go for the mid game lineup. But I'm just interested in seeing what NiP are going to do mid game when they start trying to go for those objectives that they want.
All right. And we are all interested to see that. And it is going to happen. NiP is going to go up against MVP Phoenix. And the game is ready. The players are ready. We're ready to watch. And I hope you guys at home as well. So let's send it over to our casters.
Thank you very much, Zoe. Yes, we'll be your casters for our next game of MVP versus NiP. I'm Toby One. I get to be joined by the old man himself.
Fia. That is me.
It is you. Yes, you deck it out. Like every caster has to come up here has to have a beard apart from Blitz.
Exactly.
He's the only one that's exempt from the rule.
Probably can't grow one. That's probably his problem.
Poor Blitz. Poor Blitz.
Maybe in some time.
Maybe he can look like a man. We'll get him a cutout beard that he can use for future broadcasts. Let's actually talk about our game. So MVP versus NiP. I actually want to get your take on MVP because it's the word of the tournament, the word of always MVP. No one understands their draft. How do you draft against MVP? What's the best way to approach them?
Against them? I mean, that's the hard part because they draft, like, they have such a huge hero pool, I feel. Like, they can play so many heroes. I'm not too familiar with this new roster they have because they recently shifted up. They have, like, only two members of the last MVP that I knew of, and I haven't watched any of their recent games, but they still have the same play style where they just kind of draft these heroes. Their hero pool is so large that you don't know what they're going to pick. So it's very unpredictable and very hard to play against.
Yeah. So you don't then play like a counter draft strat, instead you try and just pick what's stable in your own lanes? Or
Yeah, I think for the most part you just go with your own strategy, but you need to be able to adapt as well because, you know, MVP is a team that will adapt. And they're most likely going to adapt to you as well. So if you're not able to just change your lanes up, they might be able to outlane you very hard. Oh, and here we get the boos.
Yeah.
No one likes this hero?
Well, no one here at least, and probably no one else in the active community. Troll Warlord picked up once again. I don't think there's been a single game where he's passed the first
banned.
Twos.
Yeah. No. I mean, he's either banned out or first pick, just like every pub game.
It's just so crazy to see, like, Troll Warlord. Like, I know seven months ago, we saw a lot of Troll Warlord appearing. Then he kind of phased off the scene a little bit when his Whirling Axe, I think, was what was nerfed on him.
Oh, was it? I don't remember Troll being picked that much. It was recently.
Maybe it could have actually been longer than 6 months.
Yeah,
it could have been a year ago. Like, it was when his melee Whirling Axes did more damage.
Oh, yeah. That was a long time ago. Like, Fado's playing that mid with a mech every game.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. They also nerfed mech, too. They were using that, like, push draft, stuff like that. But, yeah, they changed the Whirling Axes. They changed the whole meta. At some point, Troll and Jug were being picked a lot. Jug was actually favored over Troll, but then they nerfed Jug. So now Troll came up in line. Yeah. They're pretty much the same hero. They both take Roche. They hit Ancients.
You still played the Jug the other day, though.
Yeah, you play Jug. They're both still really good heroes. Mm-hmm. Just people favor the Troll over the Jug right now. And right now, as you'll see, a lot of teams, they like to have a hard lockdown. Beastmaster is really good against the Troll Warlord, for example. Just get the Roar on him, kite him. The Boar is good against him, too. Force him to like ranged form so he can't just permabash you.
Yep. Well, it was actually you guys, I think, that was running the Beastmaster and Zeus dual offlane, I think it was, on day number one?
Yeah, it started as a, I think
as a mid.
Yeah.
And they just rotated up.
We just changed our lanes up a little bit. But it looks like right now MVP, Beastmaster, Skywrath, very, very strong combination. Mm-hmm. The Roar on top of the Mystic Flare. It's against Troll Ward in particular. I like having a lot of nuke damage, burst damage against that hero, because he's not that strong early game. Like, he's still pretty squishy. It just once he starts building up that Sage and Yasha into the Scotty and the BKB, then he starts getting really tanky. So taking a control of him early on, I think, is the best route.
What's your thoughts on the Night Stalker? Because it's something which NiP showed up yesterday. They picked it up as number 5 in their draft, but it was also primarily the counter a couple of the heroes. I believe even one of them was the Zeus and the Storm Spirit. But picking up in the first two, that's something I have not seen in a while.
Some teams have been doing this. It's kind of like the flavor of the month, I want to say, Night Stalker. He kind of serves a similar role as the Beastmaster, as far as like they both provide a lot of vision on the map. When it comes nighttime, you can't see very much because darkness reduces your vision by 25%.
Yeah.
So it's a lot harder to see, and he has full night vision. And if he gets up to that Aghanim Scepter, then the vision's insane. And on the other side, the Beastmaster, he has the Hawk that can scout. So both teams are really prioritizing the vision. But the strong thing about the Night Stalker right now is most teams run him in a dual offlane situation, normally as a support, and they just run in at the dual lane. They just, all Night Stalker needs is his levels. That's all he needs. He doesn't need much farm. It's nice if you can get the Ags, but it's not always necessary. So they're going to try getting that up and just get a lot of vision and control the map. So that's kind of like the flavor of the month right now, just getting a lot of vision and controlling the map.
Well, we're going to get control of the mid lane with the Shadow Fiend now arriving for MVP Phoenix. Ninjas in Pajamas removing out two heroes which we did see in combination previously, the Droid Ranger and the VS, going to be taken out of the pool. It was the heavy aura strat that happened on day number one, which Team Empire was playing. So they'll be denied that one. And a Clockwork pickup from NiP, so they pick all three of their cores straight off the front, unless, like, what I don't remember a time when NiP played a fourth position Night Stalker.
I don't remember seeing them playing Nightstalker at all, to be honest with you, but...
Apart from day number one, like, that was the only time which it flagged for me, but... If this was a CIS team, I'd say it could be a fourth position Nightstalker and that clockwork could go to the offlane, but is that something you really want to do in this draft?
Thing about Clockwork is he's fine by himself. Like, he doesn't need someone to dual lane with him, especially not a Nightstalker. That's not really going to do anything for you.
Yeah. Unless you run the Nightstalker as the mid up against the ESF, but that's...
That's a really bad matchup for the Nightstalker.
Yeah.
You'll get shut down hard. But they can still run it as a support. I'm really interested to see how they would do it, and they're going to pick up a Phoenix here against those heroes. That is very questionable. I've been seeing a lot of teams, actually just MVP, they did this yesterday too. I mean, in theory, Troll is the counter to Phoenix. You know, you pop your ultimate, every hero can hit the egg, it's dead instantly. So I'm not a big fan of that pick at all against the Troll Warlord, but they did it yesterday as well, and I believe they won that game with the Drow Ranger. They had a Phoenix there as well, and it was ran as a support. March was playing it. So I assume that's what they're doing again. And it was the exact same lane. They ran the Beastmaster Phoenix offlane together with the Drow. And I think it was a Skywrath coupling with them, with the Drow Skywrath. And they had a Shadow Fiend too. It's actually the exact same lineup, minus the Drow. So they're running the same draft that they had against, I forgot which team that was though. Where they had the Drow Ranger.
It was either going to be Team Empire. Was it?
It wasn't
Team Empire, because Team Empire ended up winning that game. Yeah. So it would have been up against BBC.
Yeah, it was against BBC, and they won that game.
Yep.
So they're pretty much using the same draft, except for they will not get their Drow Ranger this time.
Yeah, so there's no bonus damage. At the same point, it was 8 points of damage at the early stages. Yeah. It wasn't that much.
Exactly.
And Drow did get kind of shut down.
But it helps mid out too. Phoenix right click. It's just really strong with that combo. That's their number one go-to. So it's going to be interesting if they take an exchange. But they picked the Templar Assassin, one of the... I think Shadow Fiend still wins against TA mid, but TA still does pretty well against Shadow Fiend in the middle lane. So they just want a strong laning hero that does well against Shadow Fiend. There's very few heroes that can beat a Shadow Fiend mid.
It's also one of these things where you don't really care if NiP kind of lose mid, because you're going to be able to go into Roshan with Troll and TA pretty early.
Yeah, I mean, Troll and TA is a classic combination. The heroes are very strong together. Clockwork and Nightstalker, it's going to be their job to make space, and that answered our question for us. Nightstalker is going to be played as the four this game.
Yep, which means NiP just need one more support hero, and... currently, MVP thought it was going to be the Witch Doctor, but there's so many options for them here.
Yeah. Like, Rubick would be good for them.
Rubick?
Rubick would be pretty good for NiP.
What makes you say Rubick?
There's a lot of good spells to steal. The Roar is really good, a really underrated spell that most people don't steal. Shadow Fiend ult is extremely potent to steal on Rubick. You get all the souls, so it does a ton of damage. Good with Clockwork, too, for setting up ganks. You can lift people into the cogs. They just need a range support for the most part. And, you know, NiP notices that, or MVP notices that too, and they go for the Witch Doctor ban, which would have been good too.
Yeah. Well, the Slark's going to be the ban out by NiP. It's the last signature hero. I know Kat was mentioning that before when we had the MVP game, that you want to look for some kind of pounce initiation. He's better up against heroes like Batrider, the ones that can get controlled and then lose their escape mechanisms.
He's good against Troll too, because he can debuff the Whirling Axes. So he can actually hit the Troll and just go man fight him. So he's one of the better heroes against Troll Warlord.
Mm-hmm. And MVP Phoenix, last hero decision. So we're assuming it's a support Phoenix, which means we need our last number one position. If they're going to go for the aura, the only thing that's kind of left is, Luna?
Oh, they go Jakiro, okay. So I wonder what Febby's going to play here, because he's normally been playing like these hard carry type of roles, and they don't have that here, and I'm almost certain QO will play this Shadow Fiend.
Okay, can we go back to core Jakiro? Is this possible?
Yeah, it's definitely possible. I'm just thinking, like, what else could they possibly run as, like, their safe lane farming hero this game?
I hate to say it, because I know it's kind of a bit of a stigma to say, hey, you should run an aggro tri-lane, but is it possible to run Skywrath, Phoenix, as well as Jakiro as an aggro tri-lane?
It's definitely possible, and it's really possible this game because of the Nightstalker support. Nightstalker support is not very good in a tri-lane versus tri-lane situation. So one thing you can do against Nightstalker that's very strong is go aggro into him. And if they do go for the dual lanes, you force him back.
Yep.
Or you can just like sack one hero down there, which is fine. Like the Phoenix or something, or the Beastmaster will be fine against the dual lane by himself.
Beastmaster will be okay, because Nightstalker will probably never initiate.
And they go for the Dazzle. They needed a range support for sure with the Nightstalker. And so they could go aggro. It's really hard to see. I'd like to see what Febby picks up here, because that will be their core. And it looks like it will be the Jakiro. So it is a core Jakiro. And me seeing him pick this Jakiro makes me think it will be an aggro kind of like pocket strategy here. They don't want to play for the late game. They want to just take control of the early game and just get a lot done.
Well, Jakiro's old way of being played was this push into the towers. Now, Liquid Fire was pretty heavily nerfed, so it's not that big push strat which we've seen in previous times, but it's still quite potent. So do they try and force out the buildings here, or is it just purely lane control between Liquid Fire as well as Sprites?
I think they're going to go for the mech on Shadow Fiend and then just group up as five and just, you know, start taking tower after tower systematically. I think that will be their goal. And against Nightstalker, that's really good too, because they're going to... It's really, you know, you have no vision basically against Nightstalker, so the best thing to do is group up as five and force the fights. So that's going to be MVP's approach this game. They're going to group up together, take towers, and take the fights to NiP. And NiP, their team fight's not good. Like, they have the Clockwork Hook, and then they have the Nightstalker, the Troll, a lot of single target damage here.
Yeah.
So if they group up and get a fast mech on MVP, they could... But they need to win this game early, though. If it goes late game, I'm not liking their chances at all.
It's exactly what they did, actually, during their game up against BBC. It was, I think it was a 9-10 minute mech, which came up, and then they just grouped up as five.
Yeah.
And they pushed through the top lane first.
Yeah, you're going to expect that this game, for sure.
Yeah. We had our first warded placement, so NiP, they're going to have their pool camp being blocked. It's a bit more of a deeper ward coming out from NiP, and I'm assuming this is primarily so they can watch the SF stacks.
Yeah, maybe. They want to see him farm the jungle. What else would that possibly be for? It doesn't see the rune at all. It must be just to take control of the Shadow Fiend. Maybe Clockwork, if he gets to early level 6, he can get an easy solo kill on the Shadow Fiend farming those neutrals.
Alright, so lane-wise, it is going to be Febby, but he's the man moving down to the bottom lane. So the Beastmaster is still going to be run by KP on that off lane, and they let the Jakiro go directly up against the Clockwork. I suppose that's probably more of a stronger lane for you, because if you had the Beastmaster going up against the Clock, it's a little bit more of an even trade, but Jakiro could potentially harass that Clock out of lane.
Yeah, he can. I mean, Jakiro can still die in this lane if he doesn't play his cards right, but the nice thing about Liquid Fire is it costs no mana, so even if he gets cogged down, he can still always harass the Clockwork out. But Febby should have an edge in this lane, and they will be going for... I guess it's a dual offlane for now, while Nuts is just going to spam out Limp in the middle lane for now. And I assume he'll either head the top after, or maybe he'll just go bottom, depending on which lane needs it the most. But he wants to give QO a good start.
Yeah, if possible. Primarily just get those souls, but he went for Razor's level 1. So he's more direct damage into the Templar Assassin.
And his harass isn't doing much. Like, Refraction's just eating all the Arcane Bolts right now, so...
Yep. And because the bottle's already arriving for Limp, because he got the 100-100 rune, most of that's going to be repaired anyway. Looks like Hanskin, top lane, they're going in for the kill. KP trying to get himself out in the body block from the Nightstalker, extends the wings. It's not enough, though, to get the kill. Beastmaster tanky enough to get away to safety.
Yep, he's just trying to make what he can with this Nightstalker. And then he's just trying to get his levels right now. Anything he can get done will be great, but at level 4, then they can start getting, I mean, minute 4, they can start getting some kills when it hits nighttime.
I'm going to keep my eyes as well on that Clockwork. Currently, he's in fact leading the CS board. He's 6-1 on this bottom lane. And Febby's trying to keep him out, but it's still only a level 1 Liquid Fire.
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point, he's going to have a hard time now on Clock. Skyroth decided they're not going to go for the aggro, and he's just going to go ahead and help the Jakiro out.
Well, if Clock can get close enough to Nuts, he's MH hit level 2 Battery Assault, so... All he would need is that first hit and then lock him inside the cogs, and there'll be little to nothing that can be done. In fact, yep, there's your battery assault. He does have cogs available, and Febby in the neighborhood, but Johannes slowed down enough from Liquid Fire as well as the Liquid Fire that, Dual Breath and Liquid Fire, that he can't keep up to him.
That was very interesting. I think he should have got that kill for sure. Like, if you would have just cogged him in there, I think that would have been a kill.
Yep.
But felt a little discouraged by the THD coming over and backed off.
Maybe he's trying to wait a little bit longer and get a better position on the cogs and push the THD back.
Yeah, he was slowed a little bit after that, so unfortunately he couldn't reach it after that.
Mm-hmm. Well, how's our middle lane looking? Templar Assassin 8-5 up against the SF. They're practically level.
Yeah, exactly the same right now.
But Eero's getting a hell of a lot of farm up on this troll. It's actually kind of funny too with the troll Warlord. It's been a horrendous stats for him this tournament.
Yeah, it has been.
Most was being lost. That's also because BBC did run him twice on Weehar and...
And he was only picked once after that by Empire, and they won that game. But they almost lost that game, too, so...
Yeah.
His troll has been struggling. That is for sure.
Well, top lane, they wanted to come again. There's no real opening for this yet. Nightstalker... Like, what's he going to do until we hit nighttime?
Not much he can do. This is why I'm really surprised that they didn't just throw the Skywrath up here and just completely punish this lane. I feel like they would have been way ahead if they just put Skywrath up here instead of rotating them mid and then down to bottom.
Yeah, that aggro lane we were talking about, where you can punish NIP's passive supports. But now it just ends up being more time, more farm, and nothing's done during the first daytime cycle, and nighttime's going to hit in 20 seconds time. And Nightsaw can start rotating out then. You may should pick up Boots as Hunter in the night, so moving between the lanes won't be too difficult.
Yep, it looks like he's going to 4-minute rune. No, he's just going to TP bottom right now. And, oh, Clockwork? He's going to get a double maybe? Oh, that was so close.
That was not good. And this is my fault for joking about Cap missing first blood before. So 1-1, Jakiro for the Clockwork down on bottom lane.
Yeah, I didn't catch the whole thing. I just got towards the end of it. Clockwork must have just cogged in the Jakiro there. Yep. Got the kill and almost got it double. Well worth it for him.
Nuts is trying to hide in the tree line. Nightsucker wants the kill here, but he'll drag the creep wave up so potentially can dive in. The rocket is looking for the Skywrath Mage, and Nuts hit by it down to 23 HP. That next rocket 6 seconds away, but it's a level 1 rocket. It needed to be just one more point up in that. But because he was such a fighter, he went for the points up in battery assault.
I mean, if he hits it, he'll still die. He only has 30 HP. Does he go for it though, is the question.
It's gonna be too obvious. He's gonna shoot it from the creep wave.
So it looks like he won't go for that.
No.
And the big problem right now is, like, the thing about Troll is I feel like if he gets free farm like this, it's a problem, and he's uncontested right now. He's leading the net worth by far.
He did go for it. Tried next bash, level it.
Bash.
3 hits, no joy.
10% chance.
That obviously made it 30% off those hits.
Clearly.
If we break mathematics. Alright, so they are now also using the rocket to scout out Qo's flash farming. Because he's moving in and out of the jungle. The Dire Observer was still watching it anyway.
Yeah, I'm a little worried right now.
For?
Like, MVP, like, they're not getting enough done, I feel. Like, they're losing their lanes right now. And on top of it, they have a lineup that does not scale very well. So their only chance right now is, like, they're going to have to group up with the Shadow Fiend mech, which they're very strong with. And that's going to be their saving grace here.
I want to keep an eye on bottom lane again, because I think Johannes is about to have a crack at Jakiro. Hanskin was waiting for it, but the Observer Wall was also watching him very closely.
Yeah, he's level 6 now, so he can solo kill either of those heroes right now.
She got a group up. Is this smoke movement? No, it's not. It's just a normal run down. Pick up the Illusion Rune. The vision for the Radiant side did see the rune being picked up, but it didn't see the Night Stalker moving down.
Yeah, I mean, I think Febby's actually in some big trouble now if he doesn't start backing.
Actually, but, the courier might be in more trouble. Oh, wait, no, oh, that's the die courier. I take it all back. I'm tripping out.
He just dropped some wards, and it looks like he's just going to run to mid now. He would have saw that rotation on Febby, so he's playing really careful now.
But is mid rotation really going to do any work with the sentry ward down? Limp can't prep any, like, traps.
Yeah, I feel like this Night Stalker right now, he's trying to get kills, but he's not finding them. The wards are really good. And he's only level 2 right now, and 6 minutes into the game.
Yeah.
He needs to get his levels.
But he's sacrificing himself. Like, Ira's still getting a hell of a lot himself, and Steel Kid's up to level 4 on this top lane.
Yeah, but I feel like the jig's up down here on bottom lane. He's in experience range now. This is good. If he's off the map and still getting experience, that's really good for him. And still making them scared. But unfortunately, he's being scouted his movement by that ward right there.
Yeah. Maybe that's where he's also hoping he's going to find his levels by kills, but without the openings, there's no point just running in and casting one Void.
How are we doing on top lane for MVP? March is only level 2, Beastmaster's 3, compared to the 4 and 5 of the other two, so they're not doing too hot up here, but they just need their levels. And the thing that's really alarming for me is just that more than anything, it's the Phoenix who needs the levels, and he is very far behind in the levels.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about with Jakiro and actually going for your ultimate, going for the macro pyre, as opposed to stacking up further into either getting 1 point up in Ice Path or more points up into your Dual Breath?
Oh, I personally like it. And it looks like they're going on Nuts there.
Yeah, with the Battery Assault, even with the seal that Nuts got off, Johannes, obviously the Battery Assault's not going to be stopped. There's a nice hook shot in. Slow down Qo, giving Templar Assassin time to attack. The Macro Pie now doing work, burning through the Templar Assassin. He still wants Qo, and he will take it. That's going to give burst levels over to the Jakiro. So rather deep 2-for-2 trade-off was the cause. It was more, however, for NIP as far as their calls go. But even trade as far as golden XP.
Yeah, which is still favors NiP, but I still one thing we didn't mention before is like the Jakiro is very good against the Templar Assassin.
Yeah,
burns through that refraction so fast, and well, plus he
used to be picked up
either.
As like the 1v1 up against TA.
Yeah, he would destroy. Like they could have done that too this game actually. I feel and just put the Shadow Fiend bottom. If they wanted to go that route, both would have been fine.
Era's gonna have another little zone out of March. He did this previously, dropped him from 100% down to 30%. Just by attacking him a little bit. With Febius Wells Kuro in the mid, the liquid fire is burning through this tower. It's within deny range, but that's why the extra TP is arriving from the Night Stalker. Just try and push him back and then deny up the mid tier one.
Yeah, and to answer your question about the macro pyre, I like it. Personally, like a level 1 ice path doesn't really do much for you. Whereas if you go for the macro pyre, you can just stack some neutrals in the jungle and just that's easy farm right there. So you can just get your levels faster by doing that and push out waves. And in that last fight, as you saw, it did a lot of damage there, where an ice path probably wouldn't have done much.
Yeah. I'm almost surprised that Jakiro is just phased out of the meta, considering what he does offer.
I think it's because just pushing his 5 got nerfed a lot, and as an offlaner, I suppose he could be used an offlaner, but he's just not the strongest offlaner anymore. And as a support, you've got so many good supports right now, like the Lion and stuff, who have instant lockdowns that he just can't provide.
Yeah. I suppose it's different. So one is push meta, one is gank meta.
Exactly.
Well, this tier 1 tower is probably not going to last that long. You'd have to group up as a full 5 with the mech, because Kuro, in fact, is not building into that. He's going for a Yule Scepter instead. But this tier 1 tower's days are numbered.
Yeah, we do say that though, but MVP is trying to make the meta push right now.
They're going for a tower trade-off, so they bring the Beastmaster down the bottom lane, they leave the three range heroes up on top. So this tier 1 tower is gone, but NiP, you take out a trade for the tier 1 tower, you get Roshan instead. So, yeah, it's all the trade-offs.
That is a very good trade for NiP because they, as I was mentioning, they are at a disadvantage in the team fights, just nature by heroes. And with an Aegis on their hands, it kind of evens it out just a little bit.
And the Aegis will go into the hands of the Templar Assassin. So, do you want to force anything with this, or is it just more security in your lanes? You keep farming up, you still feel like you got the better timing.
Well, they're going to do a hook on the Beastmaster, though.
Yeah, catching him now down the bottom lane. Nightstalker going to come and also give a bit of a hand. And Febby maybe regretting this TP in. He might have got a Liquid Fire attack off, but he got silenced directly after. SF ulti pushing back here. The ice pass off target, but as March is up here fighting up against Johannes, Febby, that macro pie, not doing enough work. So it ends up being two going down for the Radiant side.
Still going in. Got the SF.
He's in all the way behind. And he's even got drum charges up, and Era's going to arrive for the fight too, bringing down Nuts. MVP, they're bringing more support in too, but Febby, he's knocking out retreat from this. It's just going one by one by one into the NiP lineup. And NiP come out on top. They don't lose a single hero.
Yep, and TA has a regen still. Goes back to full HP, still has the Aegis. Couldn't ask for a better fight for NiP, but NiP's game plan is they're going to dodge as much as they can or find solo pickoffs with the clockwork. And unfortunately, MVP is strongest when there is 5, and they're also strongest when they have a Phoenix Egg, which March is only level 4 right now. He needs to get level 6 to have an impact in these fights. These fights will be totally different. Even the Beastmaster is still not level 6. Like, they can't fight without these ultimates. Trying to fight like that with no ultimates up is really bad, because every single ultimate on NiP is up, and a hook is going in on mid.
Yeah. They're after March. He's got Icarus Dive away, so the Battery Assault can't control him enough. But, like, what are you meant to do as MVP? The Beastmaster tried to come to bottom lane to get a little bit of experience, and the NiP show up in force. So, you're not finding the areas to farm or get these levels onto the heroes.
Yeah, they need to get their ultimates up before they can actually fight. And then they also need to be as 5. I don't know.
Well, this is nice. They might have enough control here. Then again, there's no Beastmaster roll. So they burn through the refraction charges, use the Macro Pyre as well. But Limp, he's got Aegis Immortal, bottle charges, and potentially Meld. The Sentry Ward was dropped, but that's a little bit too far away. They obviously can't drop it any closer, or else they're underneath the tower.
Yeah, as you were saying, like they need the Beastmaster Roar. It's just another situation where they just can't get kills because they don't have their ultimates up. It's 12 minutes in the game and they still don't have their level 6s up on their offlanes.
And they're going to end up losing out in the trade because now Era takes out the tier 1 tower on bottom lane. Turns on the ultimates, doesn't really care about these sprites which have been thrown out by the Phoenix.
Very good counter to that spell and the egg. Troll ultimate.
Yep. And that rocket already doing the early chip damage. Limp taking a hell of a lot of damage, but now they can trigger a drum charge and just chase after it. Johannes going to be sealed up, so he can't hookshot in yet, but now we can. Guess the perfect double, pushing Jakiro back, taking out the SF and isolating the Jakiro inside the tree line. NiP playing a wonderful game.
Yeah, unfortunately to say, this is might be the most one-sided game we'll see. Because like the comeback mechanic just isn't there for MVP with just the way they decided to draft. They wanted to get advantage in the lanes, which I think it comes back to the Skywrath. Just, I think they chose to lane just a little incorrectly. They could have had a huge advantage, but when just didn't get the advantage they wanted here, and the lanes just went so poorly for them. They got too many levels up, and they just got shut down on that top lane, and they just don't have their levels now.
But you can understand at least the logic that was coming out from them. It's this, we're going to do better if we have Jakiro in this position. It's going to be better in that lane. They were used to running the Beastmaster as well as Phoenix together.
Yeah, I think like the going mid with the Skywrath was fine, but I think you should just rotate a top right after instead of trying to help the Jakiro bottom. Because I don't think Jakiro really needed much help against the Clockwork. Mm-hmm. But now they're in a situation where they have Roar up. They need to make something happen. They need to get this mech. Oh, he's going Yules, actually. He's not even going for the mech on the Shadow Fiend. So they're not even going to have that mecha, but they might find Era.
Yeah, with the Roar and Mystic Flare combination. But how much life points this troll's got? Not enough.
Nice. They needed that. That was big.
Yep. So they put him on the sideline. Skywrath Mage will be taking the kill, but more importantly, they just put themselves past level 7. Nova in the mid, and Clockwork's just going to walk away from this one. Qro is also in the neighborhood. The Battery Assault into the cogs, pushing Qro back, but Clockwork, the Wraith is not going to get in range for it. March, he Icarus dived in, but Limp brings in the support. Johannes able to TP back to base. He'll be able to regenerate fast enough to survive this. And the rest of NiP just bail out.
They did. March wanted to go for the kill. I was watching his Phoenix the other day, actually. I don't think he understands that you can... You swoop all the way back and you come back, he's just so aggressive with that Phoenix. And all the jokes, March is my good friend, but yeah, his Phoenix is very aggressive as you saw. And it doesn't pan out most of the time for him as of lately.
We get the items up and running now. With Qro taking this camp, your scepter will be completed by SF 15 minutes into the game. There's also a Medallion of Courage coming in for KP on the Courier. A little bit later for the Beastmaster, but it could be worse.
Yeah, and unfortunately, Roche isn't even an option with that medallion, so it's just going to be purely an offensive or defensive item, maybe put on the troll. And their physical damage, it's okay. I guess it's okay with Beastmaster because it increases like your axe damage and stuff. Shadow Fiend will hit a little harder, but he went for more of, you know, like, utility build with his Yules, so we'll see how much it can accomplish.
Yeah. At least it can be that setup, so Jakiro can do some kind of work. So they got some nice control, but NiP... They're such a tanky lineup when you look at them. Like we don't have a mech, but you've got a Dazzle behind them, and then you've got Clockwork, Night Stalker, Troll, Warlord. Three heroes, very difficult to burn through their life points. And even then, NiP aren't taking the engagement, so the T1 tower is going to be taken out on bottom. The fortification will slow them down a little bit, while up on top, it's going to be the same scenario, fortification to slow down the NiP push. So it will be a straight trade-off. But the Ancients get mopped up by Templar Assassin, and NiP probably won't even be happy with this. Let it be a tier 1 and a tier 2 tower trade.
Yeah, they just need to dodge. They realize the ultimates are now up, and for MVP, they don't want to fight into it. They have no reason to fight into it. Like, you can see, right now, Nightstalker, he even has a Midas right now. So, MVP, they are on the clock. They need to get a lot done, or else it's going to get real ugly real fast in the late game.
Yep. Well, tier 2 tower, the trade is there, and it will be a straight trade. No one's got any advantage or potential to TP back and stop it. But how long do they stop? In fact, MVP, they're not going to stop.
Yep, they can.
They have that mech up and running, so they go high ground, liquid fire into the tier 3 tower, and NiP have to come back. There's no choice. But at the same time, that's a full Desolator over on Limp. It's so hard into the Phoenix, and wants to keep chasing Clockwork. Perfect hook. Limp's going to line up with his Sideblade attack. The Mystic Flare's going to force the Clockwork out of the pit, however, with that Nova is doing his work. And, well, it is enough work to get the stuns off, so Hanskin as well as Limp, horrendous positions. And this is a big fight for MVP. They take out three. But more importantly, they can inflict damage into the tier 3 tower, forcing 5x. Templar Assassin will use hers. And how far does MVP want to go here?
It looks like they're just going to choose to back out, but this is exactly what they need to do. They have to group up as 5, they have to force them back, and they have to force these team fights because they are stronger in the team fight category. If they just let them spread the map up and they don't force these engagements like this, they're going to get out farmed and it's going to be a problem. So they just need to group up and just do it again, and most likely we're going to see that.
So, big fight, the advantage, it was heavily going the way of NiP. If you look at the graphs right now, it was 10k in the net worth and it's kicking back up. They almost got, repaired 50% of the damage in the experience gain. And that means MVP can keep moving forward. Yule Scepter coming up soon for the Jakiro. Beastmaster starts to work into those Necro books, so the next push is going to be even stronger for them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if they can get the Necro Book up, they'll be super strong. And they something weird that they did is that Jakiro went for the mech instead of the Shadow Fiend. The Shadow Fiend for the Yules. I thought it would be the other way around, honestly. But either way, they just needed the mech for the fight, and Jakiro did pick it up.
It does make a little bit of sense, though, because it was the old build on the Jakiro. You get the mech over on him, so you'd freed up your mid-solo to get into the damage-dealing items or potentially rushing up the BKB.
Yeah, I'm perfectly fine with it. I just know they needed a mech for sure. They're going to go for a smoke ink. It looks like they are going to look for a pick.
They might even check out Roshan, but with the Hulk over it, they know that Roshan's not up.
Yeah, and plus TA has a trap in there, so NiP will always know when they're in the Rosh pit. One of the great things about Templar Assassin, such good Rosh control.
NiP's getting out of here. When MVP, like, this is also something which happened yesterday, where MVP, like, it almost feels like they're telegraphing their plays too much. So you're pushing up mid lane, you showed all five heroes, and then you don't reach the tier 2 tower with even one hero. They commit all five heroes, they smoke them up.
Yeah.
So instantly NiP knows something is wrong.
Yep. Pretty, and we call that an obvious smoke gank. But very easy to read.
It's what MVP does. Like, yeah. But is it worth it for MVP to leave two heroes pushing in the mid tower? Because even then, like, if you pull back one when you got such a full five-man lineup, is it going to be obvious when you only see two anyway?
I guess they could go for two-man smoke ganks, I think, would be fine. But the problem is for them right now is, like, if they go for these little ganks and they find, like, a lot of nipplers, Hook's going up.
Yeah, but he didn't hit QO. He ended up hitting the creep. But QO, can they reach him in time? And the answer is no. Johannes actually stopped a fire off the rocket.
That would have been very close if he didn't do that. I don't know if it would have hit him, but it would have been very close.
Mm-hmm. It looks like Febby, I was wrong. It's not a Yule Scepter, it's a 4-star for him.
They are playing against Clockwork, and they don't have one yet, so it's fine. And plus, they could always just bank off the Shadow Fiend's Yules. I mean, it doesn't matter if it's your Yules. As long as someone's Yules, you can hit your combination on them.
Nice rocket. Able to scout out the fact that MVP has gone inside the pit. Now,
there's a trap there, too, so Clock could hook in last moment if he wanted to as well.
And in fact, they're getting weaved up by the Dazzle. Their armor is being stripped from them, but really, NiP don't want to fight. They just want to slow this down, so they're rocketing it up because they're pushing in the mid, they're pushing in the top. And MVP, even if they do have this Aegis, they're going to burn at least 1 minute of their time.
Yeah, they want to avoid fights at all costs, but the question is, can they split push long enough to just stop them from grouping as five? Because if they group as five with an Aegis, that's when they're at their peak. Like, MVP is at their peak right now. And it's up to NiP right now to split the map so they cannot get as five players into their base.
Yeah. And you just do this, so they're split pushing, push out the waves across the river?
Yeah, you just split push. You know MVP is going to be like a five-man unit for most of the time. So whenever you see heroes, you go to the opposite direction and you push the lane out. And they have, like, top is probably their best bet because they can go straight into tiers.
QO catches out the Troll Warlord. Ira's going to turn, looking for the bash chances. Can't really find it. The range axe, but he stayed around way too long. He actually misses on it. The last hit uphill, though, will be able to connect from QO. But Febby moving in very quickly. Actually, that four staff got him in range in time to get the ice path off.
Yeah, those whirling axes are so annoying. It's not even the fact that, like, you know you're going to miss. Like, if you get Keeper the Blast, Blinding Light, you know you're probably going to miss every, because 80%, but Trolls is 60%, so you still want to hit. Like, it's got a chance to hit them. So you're like, all right, I'm going to get this hit, and then more times than not, you just miss all of them. So he got lucky there, got the last hit off and got the kill.
Templar Assassin's about to force MVP back. With that Desolator over on Limp, the damage you can do into the towers
is... Oh, they're creep cutting mid too. This is cute.
Yeah.
To force them back so they don't have a wave.
So, how do you even get into this? Because right now, MVP, they could try and force it, but their armor's being stripped from them still. That weave has got another 5-6 seconds left on it. There's no jump in just yet because the clockwork... Well, actually, he does have hookshot, but didn't move down towards them. But you're having your armor taken away. Your tier 3 towers are getting hit pretty heavily.
This is it for MVP, though. Like, this is their moment to win this game.
Well, they got Limp. Yule Scepter up. Requiem's not available, however, and they still have to burn through the Refraction. They do it with the Ice Path into the Nova, and Limp should be dying here. In fact, he will do
no
so.
No buyback, 75 seconds.
Oh, is this now high ground? Do you just go it?
Yeah, they have to. That was a huge kill. Like, there's going to be no TA. She has, like, the highest net worth in the game, the highest level. No, he doesn't. QO has highest, but he's second highest, highest level in the game. You got 60 seconds now to push high ground. That was a very big pick off. All they can do now is just try to split push with NiP.
Yeah. Hanskin's coming back. Sealkit's the only one up on the top lane, but again, Johannes trying to just creep skip and delay the creep wave up through mid, but there's already one there. So if you're NiP, do you just let the mid-rex go?
That's a tough call to make, but I don't think they can defend this. Like, I'm not sure what they can do to possibly defend this, but they might try anyway.
You can
like
there's your hookshot in with the cogs. You're going to push Q right back out. The four-star does take Febby out with low armor again. This weave from the Dazzle's causing problems. The fortification was triggered by NiP. So they just rock it, slow him down. Beastmaster does have four staff into a roar, so it wasn't the Necro books from him as well. They want to find the initiation, but they're down to negative six in the armor, but they don't care. They beat through the melee racks. 13 seconds until this TA is up and alive again. And they're coming in closer. QO winds up the ultimate, but he's not going to find a kill with this, or maybe they will. Still kick gets roared up, so they find that one into the ice path, separating Hanskin up, but you got the buyback here and Templar Assassins up. They got what they wanted. Now, can they get out? The melee racks is down, limp with the TA traps, slowing them up. Clockwork, no hook shot for 11 seconds. And it looks like they are going to get out. In fact, they could. Yeah, they want to. They're thinking about turning it until that weave. Man, the range is crazy.
They have no ults, they should just get out.
Yep.
Bottom lane's pushing into. Even if they lose one hero here, that's fine. Which they probably will lose this beast. Oh, maybe the four staff?
The TA trap gave him the vision. Perfect. Slices between the creep wave, too. Between the neutral camps.
MVP's fine with that. They lost their Beastmaster, but they got what they came for. They got the racks. Like, Limp dying up there was so huge. Like, he had no buyback, because he had to buyback for the last fight, I believe it was. And just MVP kept pushing into them. And their problem is they have no D-push with this lineup. Like, if they come high ground with MVP, like, what do you do? Like, you can't spam. No, they have no spam heroes to get the wave out. They don't have, like, the Earthshaker, or the Sniper, Zeus. None of those heroes are in the pool right now for them. So they just have to take the fight 5-on-5 and burst someone down quickly. That is their only option.
That's not really the greatest option up against them.
Yeah, but I still think NiP is fine. It was one set of racks. It was great for MVP, for sure. But NiP at this point, they still have the advantage in the late game. If they get the BKBs up on the TA, which she is getting close to, and on the Troll Warlord, they're going to be pretty strong, especially if they get that Ags up on the Night Stalker. They'll have the, you know, the vision to start the initiations with the hook and just burst a hero really quickly. Preferably, I think, who do they want to kill? Shadow Fiend and Phoenix, I think, are really good kills for them. The two big teamfight control heroes.
Oh, but is Phoenix still a problem? Because as you were mentioning before, Troll ulti,
yeah,
you should be able to deal with the egg that way. So take out the SF before it could do anything, but he's still walking around with the Aegis the Immortal. So killing him right now doesn't really achieve much, but he will lose this in a couple of seconds.
Yeah, I mean, the Aegis will be going down before the next fight for sure. But if the other problem they have is QO dies in the fights, a lot of their damage or physical damage is gone. So if they build the PKBs.
Here they come. Ira's here as well. They let the Mystic Flare go. Clockwork's going to be burned to death. And Ira, does he have enough to get a revenge kill? Not with the four stars.
Oh, he has another boar too. They might be able to get him.
Mass TP's up towards the top lane. So they just let the bottom lane go. Yulsa dropping the air. QO, BKB, winding up the ultimate. But NiP, they back up again. Into the Nova. Where's that attack? NiP do not want it. Sealkit bails out, but Johannes, he comes in close. Hookshot is up and available, so they can go on to Febby. That armor is still being ripped apart. That's again the weave effect coming in. March has no Nova effect. He's being silenced up, so he cannot even Icarus dive himself away to safety. He'll die underneath the tier 2 tower to the Templar Assassin. The Yule Center for Jakiro buying himself some space. Sealkit dodges the ice path. Johannes still burning up a little bit, but they're going to get the secondary kill here. So NiP chasing him to the ends of the earth. But what do you really get? You got a Phoenix, you got a Jakiro. It's not bad.
But
the SF's
it's all
still alive.
Good because it creates, it's good for NiP because they need to create havoc like this. Radiant's don't let them group up as five. Like they started attack. Things bottom, started at the top. Like NiP is not very strong in the 5-on-5 engagements they were saying, where MVP is super strong. So if they can take these small skirmishes on the opposite sides of the map, it favors them a lot.
Was it still worth it though? Because the Clockwork did have to buy back for that engagement.
I think so because MVP's lineup tapers off really hard in the late game, I feel, especially with the build you have on the Shadow Fiend. You know, he has the, you know, the Blink BKB Yule Scepter build into the Scotty. Not the greatest late game build. It's more of like a mid game team fighting build. And what do they have for that outside of late game? Like, you know, the Beastmaster Aura is okay, I guess, for the Shadow Fiend. You know, Phoenix falls off pretty hard late game. Mm-hmm. So does the Skywrath. So does the Jakiro once you get BKBs up. So
I'm also worried what's going to happen to MVP once this gem is purchased over on the Night Stalker.
Because
he has the Aghanim Scepter up now. So the vision, MVP's going to get put into a position where they're going to play blind.
Yeah, they're just going to, they have to go as five, a five-man unit, hope their lanes get pushed out. They don't have very good ways of just pushing them out and then getting back to each other, like a Tinker or an Ember Spirit or something like that. So they just have to group as five, and it looks like they finally get the chance to group as five, and this is where they are the strongest. Egg is on, oh no, Egg is up, never mind, just got up.
Yep. So Darkness triggered by NiP. They need to have that vision, which means Nightstalker needs to come to the front lines. They do see QO and the Weaves having its effect over on both Febby and QO, and there's your hook shot. They catch out the Shadow Fiend, four star straight back out again, but Johannes four stars himself even closer. Here in, the SF just explodes, and now the Nova, Johannes, they turn over. That's the way to do it. The two heroes you said they had to focus down. They get back in a triple kill with Febby also dying. The TA trap revealed nuts in the tree line, and the Aghanim Scepter Nightstalker. It's an ultra kill for Limp. An MVP, the first big 5-on-5 fight that they have lost. Yeah. Heavily.
The items are now coming online for NiP. Like, when you have this vision with the Night Stalker, it makes it so easy for the Clockwork to find this target. And what was really big that fight as well is they were able to get the Weave on top of the Shadow Fiend, like, you know, 5-6 seconds before the fight even started, and the Desolator TA just blew up that Shadow Fiend in, like, 2 hits with the Troll. Shadow Fiend's just going to get focused every single fight now, and his positioning, like, doesn't matter what his positioning is anymore because the Ags is going to see him. So they're going to have to find an opening during the daytime, I feel, to take these fights, which is going to be very few and far in between, I feel.
Yeah. Right, there's that gem. So, blind time. Blind time MVP. There is one upside for MVP, the fact that Roshan is taking so long. So
it was good.
You'll have yourself a 2 minute window, but they don't know this. They may just try and come over and contest Roshan because the potential spawn time has arrived.
Yeah, I think they have to at this point. Like, from now on, we're just going to see team fight after team fight from MVP. NiP has more room to work with on the map, but MVP, they have to group as 5 for the rest of the game.
Hanska needs a range hero. That ward on the high ground, unable to reach it. But they get rid of it, they see the Hawks as well. Yeah. There's just no way, like, Beastmaster becomes a roar. That's kind of all he is right now.
I mean, you can send the Hawks out someplace and find where they're not, I guess. But if you do find them, your vision's gone instantly.
Yeah. So maybe send the, okay, well, maybe just group up as 5. One way to do it.
Yeah, they have no choice, I think.
Yeah. But they, what are they going to do? Like, pushing up mid's not going to achieve anything. And NiP have the side lanes already over the river.
And that Beastmaster actually went for a Force Staff and not a Necro Book, which hurts them a lot in the team fights here too. Like, it helps you save heroes, but it doesn't help you kill heroes. They're lacking damage now at this point.
It's getting away from the Clockwork, but as we saw previously with Jonas, all he had to do was Force Staff himself out of his own cogs and kept the Battery Assault working.
Yeah.
It was the initial control on the QO in that top fight that gave him the time to do the damage.
Yeah, so Arrow wrapped around him too. He had really good positioning as well and just got on that Shadow Fiend and he just explodes. He doesn't have the HP. They're going to go for a smoke ink here.
Yeah, and the vision is smoke versus smoke. And Johannes, well, there goes Shadow Fiend. The Ice Path, they forced off away again. A very ineffective ultimate from the SF as Era picking up the heroes behind the lines in QO. He's been locked out by the cogs. They choke pointed up perfectly. You got the roar on the Templar Assassin, but everything's been soaked up by Refraction. Era just goes to town. The Dazzle will get the kill on the SF, and it feels like the last hurrah for MVP. They were playing against the clock, and KP's on the run, but with Limp right behind him, the TA's slow, the Void as well, one attack, Meldstrike, yeah. Triple kill for Limp. He's 13-3-2 on this Templar Assassin. Roshan just spawned up as well. They pick up the Aegis, and then just, and it's also the cheese as well. They can just go high ground, take their counteracts.
Yeah, this is why Nightstalker is, you know, the flavor of the month right now. Once you get this Aghs up, it's so hard to play against. It's like almost, I don't want to say impossible, but it makes it very, very difficult to win games like this.
When you can get away with it as a support hero too, so you're getting all your damage and control you're searching for from your cores, and then you basically get a perfect walking map hack.
Yeah, pretty much MVP knew that too, and that's why I kind of feel like they went for this like kind of like TI4, like VG Gaming, like push type of strategy, and just wanted to win the game before it got to this point.
They didn't do it 3 times in a row.
Yeah, that's true. But this is kind of, it's an interesting approach to play against the Nightstalker. They did have a window, and it was looking promising for a little bit, but they just didn't have enough, you know, gas in the tank.
Well, let's see if they got enough to defend it this time. Era getting burned down, he can't get the cheese off, and into the Nova, will it be enough time? Nope, Lip will take care of that. So a 1-for-1 trade off the cogs, pushing QO back out again. He'll get the BKB, but it's already too late. He's going to lose the timing on that one into the prepped up traps. And there's also a huge amount of armor which is kicking in for NiP, so they will be able to defend their mid-tier 3 tower. It didn't cost them any buybacks, but that was also not the full lineup of NiP.
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty good for them though, MVP. Like, they did kill the troll, which is always going to be good for them, so they did hold for now. I imagine that could have gone a lot worse. They decided to put the cheese on top of the troll instead of the Aegis, so that would have been a completely different fight if it was the other way around, I feel, but I think next time TA just needs to be in front and not the troll, because you know they obviously have enough burst with that roar, so you cannot get that cheese off. Like, air is not that tanky right now. If he can't get the BKB off, there is.
We got ourselves a new item up for MVP, so the full Scotty done for QO. And Plink and Force for the Beastmaster. This is the only way he's going to find himself in a good position for a roar.
Yeah, they can see him coming from a mile away, so he needs to have some good mobility items for sure.
Poor Nuts. He threw down the sentry ward to try and get rid of the... Okay, he's got vision. There must be a hawk. No, he's lost the vision from the sentry ward, so he can't get rid of the observer. Has to throw down a second sentry ward to find the vision up on top of the cliffside.
Oh, that's a bummer. They could have just waited for the hawk, but I guess he doesn't care.
Well, where is... Okay, yeah, the hawk just flew out now. He would have had to wait like half a second.
Yeah. He doesn't have time for that.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
Era picked up a troll. I mean, Alpha Wolf on his troll, which is very, very good.
Oh, my.
So much damage.
You got that combining up with the Daedalus that's just arrived in here for Limp. And you've also got a Vladimir's offering this here for the Night Stalker. So the auras, the survivability for NiP is through the roof.
Yeah, their burst damage is insane. Whoever they go on is just going to get blown up instantly.
And it's times like this where you feel really sorry for Skywrath Mage players. Because
yeah.
You got no Ghost Scepter as
He'll
well, so you can't protect
hit.
Yourself. It's, you're dead.
Especially if he has a little bit of a weave on him before the fight, he'll just die in one hit.
Mm-hmm.
And at the best point, I want to check the buybacks right now, and only Clockwork has a buyback on the map right now. All right. I was going to say MVP needs buybacks for this fight. Unless they play perfectly.
Yule Scepter up into the Ice Path over on Limp with the Sunray. They can at least burn through the Refraction charges, but Templar Assassin's the one with the Agassi model. Attacks into QO, and they're negative armor, negative 5 right now. NiP will back up. They had the weave on top of them, so their armor is very, very high. Actually, that's going to wear off in a moment.
I feel like in this game, offensive weaves are going to be way better than defensive weaves here. Because like, there's not that much physical damage on MVP. It's like mainly just spell damage. And they have a ton of physical right-clickers on their team, so...
But do you get to a point also with Limp where you've taken away so much armor that it becomes more of a non-factor?
He still took a while to take that Shadow Fiend down, as you saw. Shadow Fiend's getting tanky. He picked up a Talisman Evasion too, which is going to be really good for him. That's like one of the best value items you can get against a troll in TA.
Yeah, especially
until
when TA went
MKBs.
For the Daedalus and not the Monkey
yeah.
King bar. And what's she really going to drop? Like the Agassi Maul to pick up an MKB? Survivability
yeah.
will be pretty rough in the fights then.
It will be. She's going to go all out damage, but she has to. Like, you can't miss your hits with a Templar Assassin. I mean, that's all. It's a single target right clicking hero, so you need the MKB on that hero. So does Troll.
Yep. And all forced by 1,800 gold spent by SF. But Troll's fine with that because he didn't... Actually, then again, look at his build. He's going Scotty.
Yeah, it looks like he has it now.
Yeah.
He should have it.
Second ultimate orbs on the courier. He doesn't have enough for the Orb of Venom, however.
Yeah, it's a really value item for the Shadowfin because he can now sit on the front line with a buyback. He needs to farm that buyback first. Tank the damage, let the spell damage come through. Like, the Jakiro's going to be doing a lot of damage and just kind of stop them from hitting their axes.
Well, hello, Limp. Goodbye, Limp. It's kind of weird that you can actually attack the Templar Assassin, but because it's the Refraction Charges, it doesn't,
blink.
Put, doesn't
yeah.
put Blink on cooldown.
Yeah, that was a pretty recent change, too. Don't get to see it too often, but when you do, it's you're like, what just happened? I thought
yeah.
I hit him.
Yeah, it seems a little wrong.
But they did it unintentionally.
Not so fast.
Okay, so MVP, they keep holding these lines, but to what avail? I'm still seeing the Templar Assassin sitting at almost 22,000 in the network.
At this point, MVP needs to farm up some key items. Like, the Shiva's is going to be really big on the Phoenix. He's still pretty far away from it, but he does have that Midas.
But do you have time to farm? Do you say, well, we still have that melee mid-racks advantage. Is that enough, or is it five-man smoke time? Get out there, find a pickoff, and look to take out a second set of racks.
I mean, it's up to NiP right now. It seems like the way they want to play it is just take full map control with the Night Stalker and out-farm them. Maybe farm up the MKBs, wait for next Roche. Whatever they want to do, it's up to them. But right now, it looks like they just want to farm up and take control of the map. And so that might give them time to, you know, get this Shiva's up, maybe a Hex up. Like, Shiva's, Hexes, all these utility items is what MVP is going to be looking for. Because there's no physical items they can actually make that'll just out-carry the Troll and, you know, the TA. They just have to outmaneuver them in the team fights.
Yep. NiP, just wait this one out completely then. Almost feel like you could play like the IG way. I remember we were casting one of the qualifying matches. And they lost vision. It was the Night Stalker with Aghanim's and Gem. So all they ended up doing was realizing they couldn't see anyone. So they smoked and ran into the Dire Jungle. Couldn't find anyone there, so they smoked again and ran to the Radiant Jungle. Eventually, you're going to find somebody.
Oh.
You just need to then commit quite heavily into your smoke times.
You do, and late game smokes are scarce. Oh, and they're going to hook in there. Yeah,
he's got an Aghanim Scepter, so he's being a little over-aggressive.
Yeah.
Are they jumping up? QO? Well, unfortunately, because he doesn't have a Yule Scepter, he can't do much. And the cogs won't allow him to move easily, and he realizes too, they're being baited up way too far. So Hanskin's the first one to come in. They realize they're being watched because of the Observe Ward on the high ground. Unfortunately for them, the Dazzle can reach it.
So actually, when did he sell his Yules? He actually sold it for like the talisman, I guess?
It had to have been, because it's the only item slot he had free.
Interesting. It was a pretty value item on Shadow Fiend, especially when they're pushing, you just Yules them, stop them, you'll have two Yules, but he decided he just, you know, needed a TP and a talisman instead, and just got rid of it.
Well, every time he's done it, well then again, at the same time, with every ultimate, it kind of feels like the SF's only just skimmed the edge of NiP with every Requiem.
Yeah.
There's never been like that right on top ultimate.
Nope, not yet, unfortunately. It's really hard to find that opening right now with all the BKBs up.
Yep. Sell a lot of money also on Lip. This Monkey King bar, if he wants it, he could sell the drums.
Yeah, he's going to. And like basically at this point, I think they're just waiting for that. They're just going to get next Rosh, finish their Monkey King bars, and just go for a Rax push. They realize they have the stronger late game, so they're in no pressure to do anything right now. I guess they feel like if they go push mid right now, have a bad fight, have the rubber band, you know, sling back in their face, they could be in some trouble.
MVP backing it up again, so Shadow Fiend can't turn down good farm up on the top lane. But at the same time, NiP, well, we got time for Roshan, just over 2 minutes for them. So it's not too far away. And all you gotta do is just keep tabs on MVP in the meantime.
Yeah, unfortunately this butterfly that's gonna come out in Shadow Fiend, it's like not gonna do too much because I think they'll probably have two MKBs by the time they want to push against it anyway.
Yeah.
So they're just kind of waiting that out. They realize the Shadow Fiend's really tanky and strong right now, and they have a lot of
actually,
spam to defend.
Actually, Error is not going for the Monkey King bar.
What is he going for then?
He's got the casual Yasha, but he built a helm with the Dominator. So he might be doing what, well, he did in the previous games, which was Satanic.
That would be surprising, but it is possible. He had that Yasha forever. He just didn't want to upgrade to Saint and Yasha at all this game, huh? Just casual Yasha the whole game. I mean, it's very casual. I mean, very standard. Oh, they're going to go.
Big hook shot in. Yep. He's going to separate MVP. Four starving back up so he can stay on top of the Beastmaster. Just get the roar on the Troll Warlord. But with a BKB up and running and Seal Kid and Johannes, they're in the perfect position to get rid of that Nova. The SF will let the ulti out, but really, for what rebuttal? The Templar Assassin's actually, I think, his death ultimate, which ended up coming in. And Johannes again with his hook shot. The Aghanim's such a low cooldown time. They just stick on the Jakiro. He might be our TP out. No, he can't. Interrupt the last moment, and that's four heroes lost. This game feels like it's over. NiP just have to go for push down mid, take mid racks.
Yeah, I mean, I see MVP's logic there. They felt like they timed it to the point where they wanted to fight during day. As soon as it hit day, they wanted to take the fight, but they still lost the fight in the middle of the day. So that's how far behind they are right now. And they have buybacks up on most all their heroes. Another hook, I think that was just creeps. Yeah, just creeps.
Yeah. He's just heading down to bottom lane quickly because if he tanks this up, he keeps the range creeps alive. So they push even harder. Double buybacks coming in now from both the SF as well as the Jakiro, but the mid melee ranks has already evaporated.
Yep. And Rosh should be coming up any second now as well. And that's their next objective.
Yeah, 10 or 15 seconds away. By the time they get there, they'll be able to check it and they'll seize up.
Yeah, and Era is going for the MKB. He does have the Demon Edge on him now.
Yep.
Just going to keep the casual Yasha. But as I was saying about troll builds, it's not an ideal situation to be in. Normally, you build the Yasha no matter what into the mask and the phase. That's your starting items. And then you get to decide, like, do I get to finish the Saint and Yasha now? Or if I'm super pressured, do I have to go straight into the BKB? And he had to do that. And then he just felt like, you know, I just don't want to go back to the Saint and Yasha anymore. Got the Helm of Dominator into the Scotty. Wanted to get more tanky.
Here comes MVP. But Roshan's dead in.
Yeah.
That wouldn't even be 3 seconds on the clock. But can they find the opening? QO jumps in, chasing after Limp, and then goes for the ultimate. Limp, he's got a BKB up and Refractory tank through so much of that damage, and now just turns into QO. The SF will be obliterated. At least they got the clockwork stuck up on top of the hillside with his four star failed down again. But yeah, you've just lost three. You're going to lose another, and there it is. GG call, 42 minutes in. NiP will take the victory at MVP. Having one very, very rough time here at the JoinDOTA MLG Pro League LAN Finals. Last thoughts.
Well, I mean, I liked MVP's idea against the Night Stalker and trying to bring back this type of, I classify it as cheese push, just grouping up as five, pushing together. I like the idea of them trying to bring it back. Unfortunately, lanes didn't work out the way they wanted it to, so they just got a little far behind and just weren't able to pull together. It's a really risky strat to try and do.
And that it was. So for me, I also thought Limp was on the mark, moving across the map so well. Ended up with a 16-3-3 result. So
very impressive.
Yeah. And MVP need to find a way to shut it down. And we'll see what they've got in the future games. But of course, for now, we're going to jump down to the panelists just to see what they thought about the game.
Thank you, Toby and Fear. We are now joined here by Capitalist once more, and Nahas is back as well. So let us talk about the game we just saw. I mean, let's start at the beginning. We saw that. We saw that. Sorry.
Nice try.
The jealousy is real. Trust me. And you will weep tears when this disappears.
It's all right. I'm sorry. I interrupted your train of thought.
It's okay. I want to actually talk about the draft there because I think Nahas mentioned that yesterday that NiP is not drafting against single heroes, but they draft against another team.
Yeah, I really like the way that. So yesterday we talked about that in the game where they picked up the sniper and Treant, which is just ridiculously overpowered anyway. But I really like in this match that they came in and they were drafting against the five-man playstyle of MVP rather than necessarily against their specific heroes. That you pick up the Night Stalker, you get the Aghanims and the gem on him, you pick up the Clockwork, you go for the early Blade Mail and the early Aghanims on him, and it's almost a hard counter. Provided you have damage output on your team, it's almost a hard counter to what MVP are able to bring to those fights. And then the Phoenix, I'm always deeply skeptical. I mean, MVP Phoenix are only 2-2 now with the Phoenix, and I'm always deeply skeptical of picking the Phoenix into a Troll Warlord, because as you saw in a couple of those fights in the mid game, which is where that hero is supposed to shine after it gets its Midas, after it gets its level 11, ordinarily you get to that level 2 egg and you feel like now's when I can start to have an impact. Well, even with that level 2 egg, Troll presses R and you're gone.
Yeah, it just disappears. And I really think that I would agree with you that they're playing against a certain playstyle. And I think the decision to focus more on smaller skirmishes, you know, 2v2, 3v3, but not being baited into too many early fights. I mean, you look at, like, despite the fact that Ninjas in Pajamas were the ones who lost the first racks, right? It actually turned out that you looked at the gold graph and it was still heavily in the favor of NiP the whole entire way. They always had control of that game. And I think that's just really good strategic read of basically, okay, we just have to stretch this out. We don't need to necessarily contest them for every single push they go for. They're trying to, they have the early game, right? They have the Jakiro push. They have an SF trying to you know, add some more physical damage to those kind of pushes. You need to be able to just let that happen and just continue to farm up as much as possible. And then when you can find the 2v2, the 3v3 fights, the smaller skirmishes is really where you saw those kind of heroes like Clockwork, Night Stalker shine in the early to mid game. And then later on, of course, we saw how Templar Assassin can be so good at that.
I was just going to bring up, we should talk about putting Limp on the TA because that's not necessarily been their style recently. Their style recently has been to have him on a very heavy burst damage hero, right? On a Puck, on a Zeus, on a Lina. And they put him on the TA. And first of all, what we noticed about Troll in this tournament, despite everybody booing when he was picked, which I still think is hilarious, is that Troll really needs another right clicker. And TA gives you that right clicker. She gives you not only the right clicking presence, but her damage potential peaks at exactly the time that you start getting maximum value from that Troll Warlord ult anyway.
Right.
So the damage potential that the two of them, provided their item progression is okay, the damage progression that the two of them bring to the table is really, really good. And I mean, I think Limp probably did as much damage there as in his best Lina and Zeus matches, which is kind of incredible.
What do you guys feel MVP could have done or should have done to somehow turn it around? I mean, NiP, they played incredible patience. They didn't let themselves being lured out into anything stupid and just played their game, which is pretty much what Yapsor said like prior to the match. Like, they just need to play their game. But what could MVP have done to not make that happen?
Ultimately, I don't think MVP Phoenix really did much wrong with that game.
I'd
I'm sure they'll
that.
Pick it apart and they'll see the small things. Oh, we should have done this a little bit better. But overall, big picture-wise, they had the right idea. I think the Jakiro was a smart pickup. I think they needed to go for that kind of push. They couldn't allow NiP to just control the late game, and they actually had to threaten them in some way, going, hey, we're going to end this game at 35 minutes before you actually have a chance to come out with a Troll, come out with a Templar Assassin, and take over the game, right? So I think it was the right idea. It's just they ran short short on Steam. And that was only because Ninjas in Pajamas ended up like staying away from those engagements. They just outfarmed they outfarmed MVP Phoenix to a point where MVP Phoenix, basically, you see it all the times with the all-in push lineups, right? This wasn't so all-in as we used to see, but back in the day, right, when the Pugna pickups and stuff, you would see oh, they have to push by 20 minutes and they have to take a Rax by 25 and a second Rax by 35. You know, it's something like that. And if you end up going past that point, the enemy team always has the better late game. The fights get harder and harder. Well, Ninjas in Pajamas just read that scenario, right? They just, okay, we stay away from the big, big fights. We make sure we don't lose this game right away. We draw it out as much as possible, and we just outfarm them. And I think that's something they did really well. And I think that's something that Templar Assassin is actually quite decent at. You don't normally think about it, but I think it actually provides more split pushing possibilities for the Templar Assassin.
Well, but it's not just those two. The thing I think that's been so good about their drafts yesterday and today is it's the Troll and TA were really good, just like the Sniper and Treant were really good yesterday.
Right.
But if you remember yesterday, they also picked two other good heroes, like the Disruptor, that scales really well and punishes over extension. And today, they pick two really good heroes in the Night Stalker and the Clockwork that take away other aspects of MVP's playstyle. And I think that this is just, it's a general trend that you're seeing against the really good teams that PPD said this in one of his draft analysis videos, that teams are thinking more about practicing a playstyle rather than practicing individual heroes and individual lineups. And I think that's really important. It becomes more important to be able to diversify your playstyles. That's a really beautiful close-up on your tie there.
Thank you.
Quite nice. It just really feels like NiP did their homework.
I really can't
say it any different. That's really the feel I'm getting watching them playing and succeeding. And that basically puts NiP now up there with EG. They're both definitely in the brackets.
Yes. I'm telling you.
We don't know which place, but they are in the brackets. The last one is going to be absolutely incredible. But we still have a few more coming up. The next one is going to be Balkan Bears Corleone going up against Not Today. But before this is going to happen, we of course once more have an image. We have a winner interview for you guys. It's going to be with Hanskin from the Ninjas in Pyjamas. So we're going to head into a very quick commercial break, and then we should be right back with the interview.